For this menu, we have batter fried fish with Thousand Island dressing. We have pondatar batayak, which are fried potatoes. And we have a salad, which is a ribbon salad with a honey garlic dressing. For that, we have two bakery products, which are chocolate mousse and a French bread. So let's look at the division of ingredients first, like I told you in the first main menu, and then we'll proceed with the platter fork. So for the division, beginning with the fish, so if you see here, we have a pie dish where the fish has already been pre-cut. We had a fillet of fish, whole fish, and we've already cut them into around 125 grams piece fish. Then for the fish, we need lime, parsley, fennel leaves and a part of the fennel stem. Then for the potatoes, we need only potatoes. And then for the salad, we need a couple of ingredients. So we need yellow zucchini, squash, green zucchini, cucumber, carrot, cherry tomatoes, walnuts, and we have about 10 cloves of garlic. So again, division very, very simple. The tray is empty. You clean the tray and give it back. So once the division is done, we are going to keep all the plates on the bottom shelf and we're going to begin with the plan of work. So to begin with the plan of work, like we always say, to keep the gas ranges occupied. So we are going to start with parboiling the potatoes. Now they're basically like french fries, okay? So we are going to dice the potatoes. We're going to parboil them very similar to how you had parboiled the baby potatoes in the first menu. Okay? So we are going to parboil the potatoes on one gas, and then on the second gas, we are going to work with the bakery products. Now the dices, the size of the dice really depends upon the chef. Okay, you can keep it small, you can keep it big, only keep it uniform. So depending upon what kind of plating you want to do, you can keep the size of the dices. Once the potatoes are diced, we're just going to add a little bit of salt. This, and this will go on one flame.
Okay, so now we'll start with the French bread. The ingredients for the French bread are, we have 250 grams of refined flour. The sugar in this bread is less. So we have approximately 5 to 7 grams of sugar. We have 10 grams of yeast. The salt is more. So instead of fat, we have 7 to 8 grams of salt. 2 to 3 grams of your fat. Some poppy seed. And this egg, only egg white is going to be used. That too in the end for egg wash. If you are a vegetarian and you do not want to use it, then you can use milk wash. We have water, we have to make a stiff dough, so we are using approximately 130 ml of water. Alright, so let's start. So, refined flour on the table, make a well, put the yeast, sugar, water and start. Make a stiff dough. The dough has to be ready in approximately 7 to 10 minutes. First add all the water, bind the dough together and then start kneading. There are different names for different shapes as we go on doing. Today we are going to do a bacon shape. toes come together with both your hands, start kneading. It's a stiff dough, but knead the dough very well, guys. Once your dough is nicely kneaded, add your fat and salt. The fat is added in this case only so that we can incorporate the salt into your dough. That is why the quantity of the fat is very less. Okay? Clean your fat and salt. And incorporate it into your dough. Once your dough is nicely kneaded, fat is incorporated, round up your dough. Now when you are rounding this up, you will find few cracks on the surface. When you round up a stiff dough, there are cracks. When you round up a soft dough, there are usually no cracks. This is a stiff dough. Tighten it from the base. You can see there are few cracks, that's fine. Put it at a corner of your table. Your surface has to be clean wherever you are keeping it. And cover with a damp cloth. Alright, we'll allow it to cook till it doubles in size and then we'll see what happens. So allow it to cook till it doubles in size and then we'll knock it back and make a shape.
So the potatoes here are parboiled. We are going to strain them in a colander. Make sure the potatoes lie in the colander itself because we want all the superficial moisture to drain out because I want to get fried in oil. So drain out all the potatoes and keep them lying in the colander itself till we fry them.
Okay, now we are finished with the dough and the dough is proving now. The French bread dough is proving. Now we will start with the chocolate mousse. Our all time favorite and very decadent chocolate mousse. So for the chocolate mousse, if you have read the recipe, first we have to make the ganache or truffle. For the truffle, what we are going to do is we are going to take two parts of chocolate and one part of cream. Now chocolate, you can take dark chocolate, you can take kuvacha. Today we are going to take Moldes compound dark chocolate. So cut up the chocolate into small pieces and weigh the cream and keep it ready. Now first we are going to melt the chocolate and the cream together. There are three ways of doing it. First and foremost, you can put both these in a vessel and put it over simmering water. The second method is where you heat up the cream directly on the flame and then switch it off and add the chopped chocolate. Never add the slab. You have to chop the chocolate and then you have to add. And the third method is putting it together in a microwave. But that is a very dicey method because sometimes the chocolate might get burnt. So what we will be doing today is we are going to heat up the cream, that is fresh cream, and we will add the chocolate. So it's one part of cream and two parts of dark chocolate. So we will start with the truffle. Okay, now what we are doing, I've taken a vessel here, it's empty, and this is 100 ml of Amul cream. Okay, so now again this is fresh cream, which is Amul cream. I'm going to put it in this vessel and I'm going to put it directly on the flame, on a slow flame. Okay, we don't want the cream to get burnt, so we'll take it on the flame. Okay, here we go. You cannot leave this vessel and do some other work. You have to be standing here and see that this cream comes to almost to a boil, because at that temperature your chocolate is going to melt. Yes, that's it. We are going to switch off the flame. Okay, now I have taken it off the plate and I come to the table. Now I am going to add the chocolate, which is chopped, 200 grams of chocolate. And I am going to stir it. This much heat is enough for the chocolate to melt. If you still feel that small pieces are there, you can again put it on a double boiler, okay, and see that the full mixture becomes nice, smooth. Okay, now can you see the chocolate has melted and our truffle is ready to be used in the chocolate mousse. Now we will keep this on the side and allow it to cool. Then we will start with the sabayon. Now we'll start with the sabayon. Sabayon, zabaglion, all this, both these mean the same thing. Zabaglion is an Italian word where it's eggs, egg yolk, egg white, sugar and Marsala wine. Today we are not using any wine or anything. What we are going to do is instead of the wine, we are going to just add water. Okay, so here we are going to use 3 yolks and 1 white. Okay, and we are going to use 30 grams of sugar. This is going to form the base of your mousse. Here we have reduced the sugar because as you all know, there is a lot of sugar in the chocolate. So obviously we cannot add 90. The recipe calls for 90 grams of sugar, but we are not adding 90. We are just going to add 30 grams of sugar. So I will start breaking the eggs and I will start getting ready for my sabayon. We are going to beat it over hot water. The temperature of the water, it should be just below simmering, okay? And the temperature of the sabayon should go little above our body temperature, but not beyond that. Otherwise, you will have a very gravy texture to your sabayon. So please be very cautious and you cannot hurry up through the sabayon. It is going to take its own time. Okay, so I'll start separating the yolks. First, I'll put 2 yolks here and then I will put 1. Whole egg. So here we have 1 yolk. Normally for all cold sweets, you need a base. Some of these desserts will have a sabayon. Some will have creme amel. Okay, so here we have to learn how to make a sabayon. Very easy. Only thing is, it takes a little time. Now here we are going to add our 30 grams of grain sugar. Don't let it stand for too long because we do not want the skin of the skin formation on the yolks. So please be very careful. And here I have added 15 ml of water. Now I am going to use the whisk and whisk it well. Okay, now we are going to start with the sabayon. I have come here on the gas range and I am going to, this water is boiling a little bit. I will just take it off the flame a little bit and then again I will put it back. We do not want the water to come to a boil. It should be on sim. Okay, it should be simmering. The water should be simmering. And then you are not going to stop at all. Your hand is not going to stop till you get a thick, frothy sabayon. We are going to incorporate air. This will take a little time. No. Now can you see this? What's happening? It's air is getting incorporated and it is becoming fluffy. Now what care should you take at this point of time? First and foremost, keep cleaning the sides of the vessel, and also you should not have any steam coming up. That means it is very hot. Eggs will get cooked around 65-70 degrees centigrade. So we do not want the temperature of the sabayon to rise too much. Now if it is too hot, you take it off the flame like this. Is it clear? And then again you put it back on the flame. So you have to keep monitoring the temperature of your sabayon. If it is too hot, the mixture is getting cooked and you will have a sweet scrambled egg at your disposal. We do not want that. So please be very careful. Keep touching the base of the vessel. You should be able to touch the base of the vessel at all times. See another way to test this is pick up this vessel and touch the base. You should be able to touch the base of this vessel at all times. If you are not able to touch it, that means the sabayon is getting cooked. Please, this should not happen, okay? So you can keep it on this side, beat it up a little bit, and then again put it back on the over the hot water. So if you get a good sabayon, obviously your end product is also going to be super. So be very cautious while making the sabayon. It takes a little time, but in the end, what do you want? A good product. So therefore, continue to check the base of the vessel at all times. Okay, now as you can see, just have a look. Nice, creamy. Creamish in color. Why? Because it's fully aerated. Now this mixture is done. The sabayon is ready. I have taken a lot of precautions to see that it doesn't get cooked and the temperature of this is somewhere around 40 degrees centigrade. Now how will you know that your sabayon is ready? First and foremost, there are two methods of doing this. First and foremost, when you hit it like this, you should be able to see the base for a split second. If I hit it like this, that is one method of doing it. And the second method of doing it is take a little mixture and can you see figure of eight? This is how you are going to check. This is done. I am going to take it off the hot water and I am going to allow it to cool. Now as it cools down, this is going to get a little deflated. Okay, now I have taken it off the flame and I have come to my table. I'm just going to stir it for few more seconds and then I'm going to allow it to cool. Now after that, what we are going to do is, when you're mixing the truffle and the sabayon, what you have to do is you have to take care that the temperature of the truffle and your sabayon is the same. That means room temperature. Both of these have to be at room temperature. Then we will mix and then hold in the rich topping. This is what we are going to do. So now I'll just keep this for cooling and I'll come back to you after some time.
Okay, so our bread has cooled completely. Now we are going to shape our bread. But before we do that, we have to keep our tray ready. So I'll show you how to grease the tray and then shape the bread. Alright, so usually when we grease the tray, we use our brush. But over here, we're not going to use our brush. We're just going to use our hands. But remember, we've done this in first year also. Very little fat has to be applied, just so that the bread does not stick. Alright. Now, two people can share the same tray. So you all are going to use alternate. Either this and this or this and this. Alright, keep your name tags ready with you. Grease it nicely with fat. Once this is done, we are going to knock back our dough and start. Usually for this type of a bread, you do not need any flour. If you are using flour, that means your dough has become soft. Okay, so I am not going to use any flour. Just pick it up with the help of dough scraper, upside down, press. Okay, once that is done, from the top, you need to start pressing it. Once it all comes together, wherever the seam is, please ensure that you are sealing it and increase in size. We are going to increase it only till this length. Alright, so if you want, for purpose of estimation, you can put this over here in front of you and increase it. Okay, once this is done, wherever the seam is, the seam has to go on the base, so pick it up from there, put it right here. Okay, so we are going to apply egg wash and poppy seeds. If you all are vegetarians, just apply milk wash or even just water, plain water and poppy seeds is fine. Okay, so this is your egg wash. Your egg wash will help the poppy seeds to stick, but it will also help you give the crisp crust that we want on our bread. Along with that, after proving, we are going to bake it with steam. The steam is what gives our product, the crust that we want. So, put poppy seeds. We are going to use a blade. There is an equipment known as LAHM, L-A-H-M, which we've shown you and told you also. So it's similar to a blade, and you have a stick which is attached and the blade is curved, so when you're cutting it, the bread is pulled. Okay, today we are just going to use a blade, hold it like this and pull it. So we're going to hold it like this and then slice it or cut it like this. Okay, it's not a vegetable, so you can't go over and over it. Just hold and cut. 5 cuts are more than enough. You don't have to go open it. It is going to open on its own after cooling. So this is the way you cut it, almost vertical to the tray. Don't cut it horizontal. Is that clear? Once this is done, we put it for proving, and once it's proved, we'll show you before putting it for baking.
Now, what has happened is that our sabayon has cooled down, come down to room temperature. Our truffle has come down to room temperature. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to add the truffle to the sabayon, mix it lightly, and then fold in the rich topping. I'm also going to add orange essence to it. Now, if you don't like orange flavoring, then what you can do is you can add anything of your choice. Coffee would be great. You add a little bit of diluted coffee powder into the chocolate, into the truffle. It takes the mousse to a different level altogether. But it all depends on individual tastes and likings. So I will just start mixing everything. Now here we have 3 things in front of me, and this is the orange essence. I'm going to add a little. Orange essence is an oil-based essence, so please be very careful when you are adding. A few drops or maybe a quarter teaspoon of orange essence we want to measure and add. Then I'm going to clean the sides of this sabayam, mix the orange essence. Fortunately, this sabayam has not deflated much, so I'm very happy. Now we will add the chocolate truffle. Now here tomorrow in class, the truffle will be made and given to you. Okay, even in the exam, you don't have to make the truffle. It will be kept ready for you. Very light movements, no vigorous movements. Now, some of the recipes, if you see, they also add egg white to make it lighter. So if you wish, you can incorporate the egg, well-beaten egg whites also, but the egg whites will go last after the cream. Basically, you can formulate your own recipe, what you like. Now we are going to add this whipped topping. 1 round spoon we are going to add. So tomorrow also you will be in class, you will be adding 1 round spoon of the topping. Because if we add too much, then it will not be a rich chocolate mousse. Understood? We want a rich chocolate mousse. So therefore, do not add too much of cream. Again, the same movements. As I just mentioned, if you want, you can add egg whites also here. Now, after the cream, you have to add the egg white. But you have to beat the egg whites stiffly. You have to make a meringue. And then you fold in the egg whites in that. But in our college recipe, there are no egg whites here. So, we will not add the egg whites. Now what I am going to do is, I want to put it in the ramekin molds, so I am going to put it into a piping bag. Now suppose you want to make a mousse cake, then you need to add some gelatin in this, okay? Remember that. Mousse cake, you have to add some gelatin, okay? I'll start piping. Okay, now I have filled the ramekin molds. As I mentioned before, it is very decadent, very rich. So therefore, you can't have too much of it, because after a heavy meal, nobody can have large portions of desserts. So here, this is just right. Okay, so we will keep this in the fridge now. We'll allow it to set, and then we will garnish it with a swirl of cream or some grated chocolate or something, and then serve it to our guests. So this is chocolate mousse for you, and I just mentioned that before that if you are going to put it in a cake, for example, a chocolate mousse cake, you need to add some gelatin to this, okay? That's it.
So now we are going to make a beetroot and a balsamic reduction for presentation. So for that we have raw beetroot juice that we are going to put little bit of balsamic. Now here we are adding balsamic actually only for the flavor, the acidity. The color has to be deep red, okay? So a little bit of balsamic, and then a little bit of sugar. Okay, this will be kept on a low flame, take about 30 minutes. Okay, so the beet reduction is happening on one gas. We don't really have anything to do on the other gas as of now. At this point of time, in the middle of our work, we need to make the mayonnaise, because that's a cold mother sauce, and that needs to go in the fridge to get completely cooled down. Okay, so this cannot be done last minute. So the next step in our plan of work is to make a mayonnaise. We all have done mayonnaise in the first year. So separate out the white and the yellow. Sugar, pepper, some salt. I'm going to add a little bit of mustard paste. Not too much of mustard, because we want a slightly pinkish sauce. And half a cap of vinegar. Mix this really well. And then we are going to add 150 ml of oil, drop that off, and form the emulsion. Okay, so now we are going to complete the Thousand Island dressing. We have made the mayonnaise, and we have to add a couple of ingredients inside to convert that into a Thousand Island dressing. I'm going to finely chop some gherkins. Or you can also use any homemade relish if you have. I want to pipe this, so I'm going to chop the gherkins really finely. That's going to go inside the mayonnaise. Okay, then I want to add a little bit of Tabasco. Few drops. A little bit of white wine vinegar. Tomato ketchup. About a tablespoon. And then about 1/4 teaspoon paprika powder. Now the quantity of ketchup, vinegar, amount of sweetness and sourness you want in the dressing will depend upon you. Some people also add onion, parsley to the dressing. So our Thousand Island dressing is ready. This will go inside the fridge.
Okay, so now my bread is cooled. Alright, You all can see over here that the gashes that I had made have opened up automatically on its own. I have not sat and separated it. So this is what we want. See the texture, it's nice and soft. Now we are going to bake it, and we are going to bake it with the steam. Okay? So it's going to go on 200 to 210 degrees Celsius with steam for 10 minutes. We need to have a nice good crust over it. So now we are going to bake it, but we are going to bake it with steam so that we have a nice good crust over it.
Okay, time to marinate the fish. Okay, so for that we are just going to finely chop some fennel stem and some fennel leaves. Okay, now fennel goes really well with fish. So it's an ideal herb to use while cooking fish. Okay, now you always make a marinade first and then put the protein inside. So if you see here, next to the pie dish, I have put the fennel. Now we are going to put some parsley in the batter. So I am just going to take the stems and finely chop it and put that as well in the marinade just for flavor. Now you can just go really simple and use only salt, pepper, lime juice and oil. Now in the parsley and the fennel, I am going to put some salt. I am going to put some crushed black pepper. In that, a little bit of the lime zest. That's really going to give that zing. Okay, and then definitely lime juice. Now, depending upon the presentation that you want to do, if you want to keep a lime wedge for garnish, you can take out a lime wedge and then take out the zest and the juice. Here I don't want to put any lime wedges for garnishing. So an entire lime juice will go for marinade. Okay, once this is done, I'm just going to mix it together and then put that on the fish. Now this also you can either take one big fillet of fish, or you can take small fillets of fish depending upon how you want to present. So marinate the fish at least for 30 minutes. Well, it's a thick piece of fish, so it will take some time to marinate. Okay, so now we are going to put the garlic and the walnuts for roasting inside the oven. This is going to be used for the salad. Just going to drizzle some olive oil on the garlic, so it's going to get a nice even brown color on top. Okay, a little bit of salt too. It's going to roast inside the oven and then we are going to make a dressing out of it. So at 160 degrees Celsius for about 20 minutes it'll go inside the oven. So our next plan of work is to make the beer batter. Alright, this batter is going to take some time to ferment and rise. Okay, so this has to be done also around 45 minutes to 1 hour before frying. So here we have one egg. I'm going to add some salt, a little bit of sugar. Sugar here is to activate the yeast. So we are going to add around 7 to 10 grams of fresh yeast. Just going to mix this. So now the batter is going to get aerated with the help of the egg, the yeast and the beer. Okay, the yeast will take time to ferment the batter. is broken up. Then we are going to add in 100 grams of flour. So this ratio is enough to make a batter for 2 portions of fish. Just going to add little bit of water. Now over here we do not have to add more water, otherwise the quantity of beer is going to become less. Okay, we are adding only that much water as needed to make a smooth lump free paste, not a batter, a thick paste. We are then going to get to the right consistency of the batter by adding beer. And beer is going to be added at the end just before frying. Okay, so we have to give time for the yeast to ferment the batter and then we will add the beer. At the end, before frying the fish. Okay, see, it's stringy. So we know that the batter is done, there are no lumps. Take out everything from the whisk and then you have to cover it with a lid or with a damp duster and keep it in a warm place so you can keep it near your gas range to ferment. Okay, so we are going to make a tui now. So we've got 5 grams of flour. In that we are going to put 30 ml of oil. That's 15, 1 tablespoon and 1 tablespoon. In that we are going to take 60 ml water. Okay, and then mix this. This garnish has already been shown to you in the garnishing video, so you can look at that also. Okay, now we are going to color this. So we are going to use a food grade color, which is black. You can also use activated charcoal if you want. So just a few drops. Okay, that's exactly what we want. And we can proceed now towards the gas range to make the tui. Okay, so you see here the bead and the balsamic, it has got completely reduced. Okay, we just need this to brush on the plate. Okay, so I'm just going to take it out in a small container. So now we need to make the tui on one gas and then we are just left with frying the potatoes and the fish. So that can be done on the other gas. So non-stick pan, little bit of oil. Whisk the mixture once just in case the flour goes and settles down at the base. Pour about 2 to 3 tablespoons of the tui mixture. Lower the flame, let it cook completely. Tui is almost getting done. As soon as the water evaporates and the oil separates out, then the bubbling will lower down, will stop, and the tui will be done. Okay? Pick it up really gently, keep it on a paper towel. Okay. Okay, so now moving on to the salad. It's a room temperature salad, okay? So nothing has to go in the fridge, neither the vegetables nor the dressing. So first we'll peel the cucumber. Okay, now it's a ribbon salad, so we are just going to take out strips of the cucumber as well as all the other vegetables. Taking out ribbons of the yellow zucchini. Moving on to the green zucchini. Just going to put this in some water. And it's your choice. You want to keep it cold, you can keep it in the fridge. You want to keep it room temperature, you can keep it outside. Okay, so for the salad, we need to cut the cherry tomato. Just going to keep them raw. Cut them 1 by 2, up to you. You can cut them 1 by 4. You can leave them whole. You can confit it, you can roast it. It's totally up to you. Then, for the garnish, just want to thinly slice some fennel. Just doing one portion of plating, so I'm not slicing more. Okay, you can keep this in cold water, it will become nice and crisp. And then just pass there, really finely chop it and put it inside the beer bag. Okay, so if you see here, the garlic and the walnut have got nicely roasted. Walnuts have got roasted. Just going to cut them 1 by 2. Again, up to you, you can leave them whole. You can cut them into slivers. You can make it into a powder. Okay, that's totally up to you. So cut them 1 by 2. So it's going to have a nice crunch. Okay, next, just going to put this walnuts here on this plate. And then I'm going to take a bowl. I'm going to make the dressing. For the dressing, we have these nice brown colored roasted garlic. In that, I'm going to add a couple of ingredients. First, oil. Then, in that, we'll add some salt. Pepper powder. I'm going to add in some herbs. I'm going to add some mustard paste. I'm going to add some honey. Again, we don't want the dressing very sweet, so 1 tablespoon honey is fine. And then we're going to add some lime juice. You can also add some white wine vinegar if you have, if you want. Okay, so 1/3 of a lime squeezed, and this will go inside the mixer to form a nice smooth dressing. Okay, so now only frying up the potatoes and the fish is left. We're going to fry the fish at the end. Time to fry the potatoes. Put them in hot oil. Now if you see, the potatoes are almost cooked. Alright, so we just want the nice golden brown color on the outside. We want them nice and crispy. And then we'll take them out. Side by side, we will add the beer in the batter. Okay, so you see the potatoes, they're getting nice and brown. Side by side, if you see here, the batter has got nicely fermented. In this, we are going to add some beer. Okay, part by part. Last thing we want is a thin batter. Okay, now you're going to mix this lightly. We don't want the aeration to go or the batter to become flat. So just mix it gently with a spatula, not whisk it vigorously. The potatoes are done. nice golden brown color. So we'll take them off. Don't switch off the flame, lower the flame. We'll immediately fry the fish. Here we will just sprinkle some salt on the potatoes when they are hot. Okay, after you add the beer, just add in the parsley and mix it lightly. Put the fish in the batter. We need a good layer of batter on the outside. Okay, so take the bowl on top and just leave the fish inside. Okay, so you see the fish is getting fried. Now you have to really manage the flame, okay, because the fish is quite thick. You want the fish to cook completely from within, and you want a nice golden brown crusty cover on the outside. Okay, so you have to make sure that the flame is not too high, not too low. Nice golden brown color. Okay, so we have made this beet and balsamic dressing reduction here. That's going to go on the side of the plate. We are going to place one piece of fish. Then on the side, we are going to put potatoes. Even in your exam, you are going to present one plate of the food. So the good looking pieces of potatoes will go on the plate. We are going to put the sauce in between, the Thousand Island dressing. And then cover up the gaps. Then we have the fennel shavings.
One second.
We are going to put some fennel leaves. We have fish. We have fennel leaves here. And then on top of the fish, just going to break the tui and then put it on top. Okay, so that's your presentation of the main course. Okay, so for the salad, we are going to first take the dressing. Okay, spread that. Just drizzle a little bit of oil just to give that glaze. And a simple mounted salad with the ribbons. Now depending upon what portion size you want to maintain. Okay, it's not the main course quantity. Next, just want to put some rocket leaves. So rocket really has a nice pungent flavor that's really going to add to the taste of the salad. And then some cherry tomatoes here and there, not too much. Walnuts, and then finally some mint leaves. Not too many mint leaves because we already have rocket. Okay, final drizzle of oil. We're done.
Okay, so our bread has baked, it has come out, it has cooled, only then do we slice our bread. Slice it at an angle, alright. The crust has to be nice, thin and crisp. The crumb is a little open as compared to your soft roll bread. Your soft roll crumb will be very dense. This is a little open. Okay, so for garnishing your chocolate mousse, your chocolate mousse is set nicely. We are going to garnish it only with a swirl of cream because you are going to work in the kitchen. That's why I'm not showing you any chocolate garnishes. If you're working in the bakery where there would be AC, we will show you some chocolate garnishes and you all could also do. So that's in the next sem that we'll do. But right now we're just going to do a swirl of cream over each. And if you still want, you all can grate some chocolate over it and put it. But for now, we're just going to do this much and here.